By way of introduction, my name is Eimear Mulhern, and I'm a daughter of Maureen Lemass, the eldest of Seán Lemass's children, and Charles Haughey. And I'm a granddaughter of Seán and Kathleen Lemass, therefore. On behalf of the extended Lemass family, I'd like to warmly welcome you to this webinar, remembering Seán Lemass on this, the 50th anniversary of his death. In particular, I'd like to extend a warm welcome and sincere thanks to our esteemed guest speakers this evening, Senator Tim Kennedy of New York and the Fianna Fáil TD for Dublin Bay South, Mr. Jim O'Callaghan. You are both most welcome and thank you for agreeing to join us. My cousin councillor Rory Lemass, Rory O'Connor, will make the closing remarks. I know you're anxious to hear our speakers, but briefly, I would like to give you a few words on Seán the man, our grandfather, and the person that we knew and loved so much. Seán was born in Capel Street in Dublin. His parents had a milliner's business there. And my mother used to say that was why her father always was pictured and always wore such a fine hat. He married his childhood sweetheart, Kathleen Hughes, and they had four children. He and Kathleen had a wonderful, happy marriage and remained childhood sweethearts till the day they died. Our childhood memories of Seán would be of him at his home in Rathfarnham, where he spent the latter part of his life. He was a warm, kind and gentle man, while also keeping his counsel in many ways. He loved to fish and play cards and always enjoyed a day at the races. His best friend was the comedian Jimmy O'Dea, and he and Kathleen lived a simple life in the company of family and a few close friends. As children, we always looked up to him and we knew he was someone who had achieved much. He had a quiet presence about him. We were particularly proud of the part he played in the rising of Easter 1916, of his being in the GPO and the escape and the surrender, his arrest and subsequent release from Kilmainham Jail. My mother always said that an OU seaman recognised him and his brother Noel as they were being brought into Kilmainham. And he said, "That's the two young Lemass boys. They're way too young. Send them home to their mother." And thankfully, at the age of 16, he escaped execution. We knew very little of his life as a soldier. We had no idea of just what he lived through, of the pain, suffering, and the loss he experienced. In fact, my mother said he never, ever spoke of those times. They were probably too raw and too painful. He suffered the pain of his beloved brother Noel's torture and death at the end of the Civil War and never spoke of it or seemed to carry any animosity or hatred. In fact, it was said that he learned of the identity of his brother's killer and that he subsequently worked with that person in the course of his political life. My mother was still learning things of his early life right up to the time of her death 5 years ago. What impresses me most of him was how this young Irish freedom fighter with little formal education, as he joined the volunteers when he was 15, transformed himself to being one of the most inspirational political leaders that this state has ever produced. My mother told us he spent his time in prison, in Ballykindler and the Curra, reading. He read biographies of the great political leaders. He learned about economics and educated himself in all sectors required to make the transformation to the visionary politician he subsequently became. And that brings us on to the topic of our discussion tonight. And I would now like to pass you to our esteemed speakers. All of us, I know, are greatly looking forward to what they have to say. Thank you very much. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our guest speakers who've joined us here this evening. and particularly would like to thank Senator Tim Kennedy, the Democratic Senator for the state of New York. You are most welcome, Senator. Senator Kennedy, as many of you know, is extremely proud of his Irish heritage and is very proud and is a very proud member of the New York Senate's American-Irish Legislators Society. Among his many duties and responsibilities, he is also chairman of the New York State Committee on Transportation and is chairman of the New York State Senate Subcommittee on State Native American Relations. Welcome, Senator. We are greatly honored that you have agreed to join us. We know you have a heavy schedule, and we deeply appreciate you taking the time out to remember Seán Lemass this evening. Thank you very much.
Wow, thank you very much to Emer Mulhern. Good evening, everyone on both sides of the Atlantic. I am so honored to join you here today. I want to recognize the other special guests, Councillor Rory O'Connor and TD Jim O'Callaghan. And you know, when we were in the weight room before we got started here, I mentioned to see a Mulhern and O'Connor and O'Callaghan. I feel like I'm back home in my neighborhood in South Buffalo, New York, the Irish capital of America, I will argue. And I don't care what my friends in Boston or New York City have to say. It's Buffalo, New York. You can look us up in the U.S. I am here today to really pay homage to an extraordinary individual who really transformed history, not just for the island of Ireland, but for U.S.-Irish relations and arguably the economy of the globe. You know, we owe so much to the legacy of Seán Lemass. And I think Emer as a granddaughter and Councillor O'Connor as a great-grandson will be able to share more of the story of the man, of the individual who was so passionate about his country and, you know, caused at that time, in the words of the late great Congressman John Lewis, good trouble. It was about creating an environment for freedom to which those that lived before him on the island were not able to share, were not able to have the freedoms that we often take for granted today. Again, on both sides of the Atlantic were the freedoms that were fought for and those that came before us bled for and often died for that we have today. And so when we think about Seán Lemass, the man, we have to remember where he came from and to think about what Emer Mulhern just spoke about, her grandfather, a freedom fighter that was born into an Ireland that was different than we see today and certainly different than the Ireland that he left when he passed 50 years ago today. We have to remember those, including him, that made it happen. Without him, we would have a much different world. And to think about the relationship between Ireland and the United States is absolutely crucial to consider the fact that Taoiseach Seán Lemass brought our great countries together to a level that they hadn't been before. He was crucial in rebuilding Ireland's economy. And now, and I hope everyone is staying safe as much as we can through this terrible pandemic, but now we're dealing with COVID and we are thinking about a post-pandemic world. We have to think about our economy after COVID, the economy that leaders at the time, like Seán Lemass, would be thinking about in order to, you know, continue progress. We have to stimulate an economy, grow jobs, grow opportunities, and that will lead to prosperity, and that will lead to peace, and that will lead to progress. But the relationship between Ireland and the United States was certainly built with the help of the seeds planted by Seán Lemass and the strategy that he created that allowed for an open, modern country eager to attract an inward investment when he was, head of the government. You know, he took that message that Ireland was open for business on both sides of the Atlantic when his work commenced in the 1950s. You know, that relationship between the United States and Ireland that we know that was built centuries ago, but then was effectively grown by the many refugees that left Ireland to come to the United States during the Great Hunger, including my family. And he knew that in order to build a better, more prosperous Ireland, that borrowing from the words of the Irish Proclamation, Irish in America, those that had emigrated to America were also connected to a future in Ireland. And he knew that by building a relationship with John F. Kennedy as president of the United States in the 1960s, it would yield huge economic benefits for both Ireland and the United States. And that vision has become a reality. The seeds that were planted by Taoiseach Lemass and President Kennedy, especially during President Kennedy's visit back in 1963, produced a harvest of jobs and innovation and cooperation, prosperity in subsequent decades. Today, there are hundreds of thousands of people in Ireland that are employed directly and indirectly by United States companies in Ireland. It works for all of us to have these companies that are prospering on both sides of the Atlantic. You know, it also helps to further the friendship and the bonds that are not just familial and bloodlines, but that will be shared by those that are not of Irish descent, again, on both sides of the Atlantic. These bonds of friendship between Ireland and the US, though, have never been stronger following the election of our current president, Joe Biden, a man that I am so proud of, that I was an early supporter of, and in large part because of his proud Irish ancestry, and in large part, my commitment to this president as a candidate and as a senator was because of his longtime commitment of support to the Emerald Isle. And we know that President Biden is a strong supporter of the Irish peace process and the Good Friday Belfast Agreement. We know that he continues the hugely valuable work that was laid before him by President Bill Clinton, who displayed great courage in endorsing the peace process as promoted by the late John Hume. And in his support for the Good Friday Belfast Agreement, President Biden's also building on the vital contribution made by Senator George Mitchell, who chaired the negotiation process. So never before has Ireland and the United States have a relationship that's been so important in safeguarding peace on the island. And so we have to build on these foundations first laid down in the Lemass-Kennedy era that'll be essential in the coming period of growth in a post-pandemic global economy. So when we're talking about the green technology to pharmaceuticals and from finance to the ICT sectors, the leaders of Ireland and the United States have to emulate the bonds that were formed during Taoiseach Lemass and President Kennedy's tenure and really build off of their legacies of growth that past generations have been doing. And so again, I'm just so honored and privileged to be in all of your presence, to celebrate the extraordinary life and contributions to Ireland, to the United States, and to the global community of Seán Lemass, who we sadly lost 50 years ago today, but whose legacy clearly continues to live on. And I will continue to do everything in my power to grow the bonds of friendship, of our economies, of prosperity, and of peace between the United States and Ireland. And as we look to the future with great promise and pride, you can count on me personally. You can count on New York State to be there. You can count on our continued growth of the Irish American Legislative Society to a national society that we're working on right now. I want to recognize my great friend, the head of the Irish Sinead, Senator Mark Daly, who helped to bring me together for this day here as well today, and so many of my friends that are both members of Parliament as well as members of the Irish Senate that work so hard, both in the Republic and in the north of Ireland, as we work to unify our country into the future and really see through the vision of former Taoiseach Seán Lemass and make that a reality. We look forward to being a part of that process. And again, thank you for having me here today.
Thank you very much, Senator, for those wonderful words and for your unwavering support for Ireland. The relationship between Ireland and America is such an important one. And having people like you flying the flag for our country in America is just such a wonderful thing. And thank you very much. And of course, there probably is no prouder American that we've seen in recent times anyway than President Biden. And he certainly wears his Irishness right in his heart, and Ireland has embraced him with just the warmest of good wishes. So we look forward, maybe if he comes to visit us, you'll come with him at some time in the future.
I'm looking forward to the day to get back.
Thank you. Senator, you might stay with us for a little while. We may have some questions that our participants would like to ask. So if you'd stay with us for a little while, we'd be most grateful.
I certainly will.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Jim O'Callaghan, well known to many, I'm sure. Jim, as you know, is the Fianna Fáil spokesman for justice and is TD for Dublin Bay South. He has represented this area since he was elected in 2016. Interestingly, Seán Lemass represented the constituency of Dublin South until 1944, and then he moved on. It became the electoral area of Dublin South Central, and he represented Fianna Fáil as a TD for over 40 years. Thank you for joining us, Jim, and thank you for being with us this evening.
Thanks very much, Eimear. And the first thing I want to do is I want to thank yourself, and I want to thank Rory and all the family of Seán Lemass for asking me to speak at this event. I also want to say how pleased I am to be able to speak on a webinar or a modern day platform with Senator Tim Kennedy. And I listened very carefully to the words that the senator spoke, and it is clear that he's an extremely genuine and knowledgeable American politician. And he continues in that long line of American politicians who have in-depth and genuine knowledge of Ireland, and long may that continue. Listen, I think it is completely appropriate that today, 50 years after Seán Lemass died, that we mark and celebrate his life. And I know, Eimear and Rory, for members of the family, today is a day for you to recall a loving grandfather, or indeed great-grandfather. But let's remember for the wider public as well, this is an important day, and it's the day to recall and acknowledge the political career and contribution of a man who had, as Senator Kennedy said, a transformative effect on Irish political and economic life. Like you will know, Eimear, from the brief description you put out there, that there were many phases to the long public life of Seán Lemass. From the time as a young man, or indeed as a boy, he was involved in 1916, up to 1966, when he retired as Taoiseach. And his life encompassed the history of the early part of Ireland's revolutionary period, and indeed the part of independent Ireland. But I suppose, since I have a limited amount of time, I wanted to speak about what I viewed as being the most impactful and influential part of Seán Lemass's career. And that was the part of his career from the mid-1950s onwards until he ended his term as Taoiseach in 1966. The reason I wanted to just concentrate on that was because that was the time when decisions were made by Seán Lemass, which changed the direction of this country with long-lasting beneficial effects. And I think if we were to ask people to provide a list of who are the people responsible for Irish independence, it would be impossible for us all to agree on a list. There'd be hundreds of men and women on it, dating from not just the 20th century, but indeed the 19th century. But the reason why Seán Lemass was so transformative is that if we were to ask people, who is the politician in Ireland that changed the economic direction of this country, that moved us from being an agrarian-based economy towards being an open, industrialized, knowledge-based economy? I think most people would agree that the politician responsible for that was Seán Lemass. And I wanted to just look at the origins of that transformation that took place. And I think to understand it, we have to go back to the decade after the Second World War. And that was a very difficult time for Ireland and indeed for the Irish public. Then I think it's apparent when you look at the governments from 1945, say, to 1957, there were very limited achievements. And that applies to governments of every hue. There were the inter-party governments and Fianna Fáil governments. I think Seán Lemass recognized when he was Minister for Supplies during the Second World War, he recognized that protectionism and tariff barriers were having a very negative impact on Ireland. And I think it was as a result of his recognition of the limitations of protectionism that that whole system ultimately collapsed. And one thing I'd like people who are watching this evening to be aware of, we automatically assume that Ireland was inevitably going to become this modern, knowledge-based, open economy. But like, there was no inevitability to that at all. And like, we know that in the 1950s, Ireland was an agrarian-based society, and it was an economy that wasn't outward-looking. And it had been that way for over 100 years up to that stage. But we need to emphasize that there was nothing inevitable about us becoming this knowledge-based economy. It only happened as a result of people such as Seán Lemass recognizing that the country needed to move direction in order that we could change the course of Irish economic development so that we could create greater opportunities for the Irish public. And I think we need to recognize as well that it wasn't inevitable that this was going to happen. But there were also consequences to the decisions that Seán Lemass made. Like, we're now this year celebrating 100 years, I suppose, of our departure from the United Kingdom. I suppose there are other ways when we don't celebrate. It's also 100 years since our country was divided, and many of us look upon that with great regret. But one of the issues that isn't disputed, and no commentator suggests it, is that nobody says that we made the wrong decision to leave the United Kingdom back 100 or more years ago. And I think the reason in part that nobody suggests we made the wrong decision is because it's apparent that today Ireland, notwithstanding our very clear challenges and political issues, but it is clear that we are a successful, independent European country. But the reason why nobody challenges our independence and the decision we made is because we were successful. We've become a successful country. But I have to say to you, had it not been for the policies and decisions of Seán Lemass, we would not be as economically successful today as we are. And in many respects, I suspect if we had remained as an agrarian-based society, many people would be challenging, why did we ever bother leaving the United Kingdom? So part of the reason why that issue is not questioned today is because of the very strong policies that were introduced and the change of direction made by Seán Lemass from the mid-1950s onwards. I also think we need to recall that at the time he developed his policies of transforming Ireland's economy in the 1950s, very many progressive elements in Ireland thought this was a bad decision. For instance, I was reading recently a report in the Irish Times from October 1955, and Seán Lemass had given an address to Fianna Fáil Cóirle Dalcántar in Dublin about how we needed to change our industrial policy. At that time, he was in opposition. But this was met with a very negative response by an editorial in the Irish Times the next day, where they criticised Seán Lemass for trying to change what was Fianna Fáil policy. And they criticised him for seeking to suggest that we should try to move away from an agricultural-based economy. And what the editorial said is that it said, the proper course is surely to work for the industrialization of agriculture, for the rehabilitation of agriculture, and at least a doubling of its productivity, rather than to concentrate on manufacturing industries which have no root in our resources. Has Mr. Lemass and has his party, if he speaks for it, abandoned all hope of a unified Ireland, which might find itself disastrously overstocked with manufacturing industry? So, like, notwithstanding the widespread opposition to changing economic course, and that's apparent from the Irish Times editorial there, Lemass persisted and recognized that we needed to change economic course. I suppose he was lucky as well in that at the time Seán Lemass became Taoiseach in June 1959, it was only 7 or 8 months after the publication of the first program for economic expansion, which had been written, as we know, by T.K. Whittaker. And I think the combination of that policy and the energy of Seán Lemass ensured that Ireland was going to change economic direction. Another great attribute of Seán Lemass, and it's something probably Emer will know more than the historians know about, but he appeared to be a man who had a great sense of optimism, and he had great desire to challenge senses of pessimism or despondency. And that was recognized, I think, in the Dáil some months after he was elected Taoiseach. He was elected in June 1959, and in December 1959, in the Dáil, he said, "The most encouraging feature in the national situation at the present time is the disappearance of those clouds of despondency which hung so heavily over the country only a couple of short years ago." So he refused to accept despondency, and he really inbred a sense of national self-confidence in the Irish people. In fact, if you look at John Horgan's very fine biography of Seán Lemass, you'll see that he ends it by stating that the abiding legacies of Seán Lemass were in part the fact that he'd created this spirit of national self-confidence. And listen, I think there's a message for us all today in how Lemass responded to the pessimism that permeated Ireland in the 1950s in the aftermath of the war. But the most important thing that Seán Lemass had in responding to that was that he knew what he wanted to do. And that probably is one of the most important characteristics for a political leader, that you know what you want to do. And he wanted to end protectionism. He wanted to remove tariffs. He wanted to industrialize Ireland, and he wanted to modernize Ireland's economy. And also, in respect of Northern Ireland, he wanted to move beyond what were dated and unsuccessful policies on Northern Ireland, and in particular, policies that we were probably guilty of down here in terms of completely ignoring the existence of unionism. But Seán Lemass wanted reunification, and he wanted it to be brought about through consent. And I suppose all of these objectives are now viewed by us as being natural and inevitable. But as I said to you before, there was nothing inevitable about the change from Ireland's economy and Ireland's society from an agrarian-based society to where we are today with this modern European knowledge-based economy that is attractive to the world. And that's why we have so many companies in Ireland which have come from Senator Kennedy's country in the United States. I think it was also Seán Lemass who had the vision to see that Ireland could proceed in a different direction. But as well as that, his timing was very good. I know there are many members of Fianna Fáil and indeed other people who think, you know, Seán Lemass was a bit unfortunate in that he became leader when he was nearly 60 years of age and it was too late for him. In a way, I disagree with that, because had he become Taoiseach sooner, had he become leader of Fianna Fáil sooner, I think the world wouldn't have been changing at the same time. And it was the fact that Lemass and the world were changing at the same time that was so effective. And I suppose if we look at it, Seán Lemass took over from Éamon de Valera, who was the founding figure of the Irish Republic in many respects. And he did so at the same time when other elderly figures in politics, such as Churchill or Eisenhower, were moving on. I think also the arrival of President Kennedy in the White House in 1961 was also very significant from Ireland's point of view, because that was a time of excitement in the world and in America, and there was a recognition of the opportunities that were available to countries around the world. And Lemass grasped that opportunity. And in fairness, and with all due respect to President Kennedy, Lemass knew where he was going even before President Kennedy was sworn in as president. Senator Tim Kennedy mentioned earlier on about the visit of President Kennedy to Ireland in June 1963. I had the opportunity to, when I was in Boston a number of years ago, to look at the video of that tour. And it's such an emotional moment for Irish people. And I know it must be such an emotional video for American people, such as Senator Kennedy as well, to see that promise. But the affection between President Kennedy and our Taoiseach Seán Lemass. But it's important to recall what President Kennedy said of Ireland that was led by Seán Lemass at that stage in 1963. And President Kennedy said that Ireland had undergone a new and peaceful revolution, an economic and industrial revolution, transforming the face of this land. You have modernized your economy, harnessed your rivers, diversified your industry, liberalized your trade, electrified your farms, accelerated your rate of growth, and improved the living standard of your people. Now, that was John F. Kennedy speaking about what Seán Lemass had done to Ireland. And remember, at that stage, Lemass had only been Taoiseach for a period of 4 years. I know that subsequently, Taoiseach Lemass went to the White House. President Kennedy at that stage described Ireland as a vigorous new country which looks to the past with pride and the future with hope. So listen, I think there are wonderful images and recollections of the relationship that existed between Seán Lemass and John F. Kennedy. There's another part of Seán Lemass's legacy that I briefly want to refer to, and that is his legacy in respect of Northern Ireland and how unlucky we were in a way that Seán Lemass didn't have more time to lay the foundations in respect of a relationship with Northern Ireland in the same way that he built foundations to change the Irish economy. We know that he met with Terence O'Neill, the Prime Minister of Northern Ireland, in 1965. And the meeting and how it occurred, I think, gives a good insight into how Seán Lemass operated as a politician. We know from state papers that T.K. Whittaker brought O'Neill's private secretary, Jim Malley, to see Mr. Lemass on the, I think it was the 4th of January, 1965, with a message that, in fairness, had come from Captain O'Neill. And O'Neill said that a fresh approach would be made in the matter of cooperation between the two parts of Ireland. He thought that such an approach should be made, and he extended an invitation to Lemass to visit him in Belfast. Now listen, that was quite a radical thing to do at that time. And it was also a radical thing for Seán Lemass to do as well. But Seán Lemass didn't wait to consult with his cabinet colleagues. He didn't feel obliged to go and consult with President de Valera. He made the decision immediately and he accepted the invitation from Terence O'Neill. And the meeting took place the following week. And Whittaker gives a very good account of the meeting between the two of them. Apparently, when O'Neill met him at the border, he said, maybe we should have some champagne to celebrate the meeting. I think Emer might know from the books I've read about Seán Lemass, I don't think champagne was his tipple. But there was a good relationship there. And the meeting explored the possibility of practical cooperation. And when you look at the records of those meetings that took place between Seán Lemass and Terence O'Neill, they discussed issues such as the joint promotion of tourism, cross-border exchanges of education, teachers and pupils and scholarships, cost sharing in the health services, the elimination of wasteful bidding for industrial investment, joint agricultural research and sort of cooperation on electricity. So like they were ahead of their time. But of course, we know what happened, and it is one of the great losses of, I suppose, Irish history, that we lost the North at that stage. And unfortunately, the hardliners were able to block and destroy the cooperation that O'Neill and Lemass wanted to see achieved. And, you know, as I say, regrettably, the rest is history. But how different the history of Ireland may have been if Seán Lemass' vision, and in fairness, Captain O'Neill, his vision was allowed to become a reality. Yes, I'm going to conclude by simply stating that Seán Lemass's legacy lives today, and it lives in the investment that Ireland has made in knowledge and the skills of our people. It lives in our strong membership of the European Union. It lives in our pro-enterprise economic policies, in our cooperation with all the communities in Northern Ireland, and our quest for reunification and enduring peace on the land of Ireland. Like Seán Lemass, he wanted to create a land of freedom, of opportunity. He wanted to see access to education as a right. He believed the owning of one's home was a right, the respect of realizing one's full potential. These were all the cornerstones of Seán Lemass's policies, and they were the policies of a true republic. So listen, I'm conscious I've gone on probably longer than I should, but can I just say that today in Ireland, we face many challenges, and we should face those challenges with the same relish that Seán Lemass would meet those challenges, because he viewed challenges as opportunities. And that's how we in Ireland today should view the challenges that face us. And he would see the great opportunities that the challenges present us. And if we're to be true to his legacy, we must see those challenges as opportunities as well. So thanks very much, Emer. I was going to finish up there, and I'm conscious a number of questions have come in to me, Emer. I don't know, will I read them out, or did you
please want... Please do.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. I'm sorry for going on a bit longer than I am.
No, Jim, just to say thank you very much on behalf of all of us. That was a wonderful speech, quite emotional, I have to say, for us. And very, very interesting. And thank you so much for your wonderful
words. You're very welcome. And listen. And Tim, sorry, as a member of Fianna Fáil, I know every member of Fianna Fáil is so proud of Seán Lemass, what he did for Fianna Fáil and what he did for the country. Tim, would you mind, there's a question has come in, and it's about President Biden, who, as you say, is, he's so proud of his Irish roots, but he's also a very astute and shrewd politician who's having a transformative effect on America. Could I just read out a question that one of the guests has asked, and it's from a guest called Ted, and if you could give a response.
Great.
And Ted asks, he says, President Joe Biden follows in the footsteps of President John F. Kennedy in becoming another Irish-American elected to the United States' highest office. What are the opportunities presented by the Biden presidency for the island of Ireland?
Yeah, well, that's a great question. And I will say to you as well, Jim, that was a wonderful presentation. And truly encapsulating the legacy of Seán Lemass. You know, President Biden, I mentioned earlier, we are so proud of him. And I mentioned earlier also, you know, what really captivated me to his leadership style as a senator, as a candidate, and now as president. And quite frankly, it started with his deep-rooted connections to Ireland. Everything that he has done, I have looked upon and said, you know, he thinks like I think. You know, he's made decisions the same way I would make them. And I think I speak for many in our country, and I speak especially for Irish America that watches the way President Biden works each and every day. He is somebody that is in constant a constant connection with his own soul, and he's driven by what's in his heart. And especially here in Irish America, we are driven by the lessons that we learn that are instilled in us by our parents, our grandparents, and generations before them that have been passed down much alike to what those that grow up in Ireland, experience. And we always remember, especially in politics, there's an old saying, never forget where you come from. Well, us here in Irish America, we never forget where we come from, and we celebrate where we come from. Those ancestors of ours that, whether it was 10 years ago or more likely in the last century to 150, 170 years ago, again, during the Great Hunger, that escaped the Great Hunger to find a better life of prosperity for themselves and their families and future generations that they will never meet, like myself and like President Biden. And so when you bring President Biden's name up and talk about his connection to Ireland, remember that he speaks for Irish America as much as he speaks for America, and his relationship to Ireland is very, very intimate, like all of ours is, because again, we are here for a reason. We are on this side of the Atlantic for a reason, and we never forget that, much like President Kennedy. By the way, as we all know, the only other Catholic president that was inaugurated here in our country, not the only president with Irish roots, but I would argue the only president with our kind of Irish roots that, you know, has an especially deep rooted familial and personal connection to Ireland and its history, as well as to the present day Ireland and the future of Ireland. So we are committed on a very personal level to the peace and prosperity and economic growth in Ireland. And I believe that that's how President Biden operates. That's how he thinks. He wants to create a relationship like there never has been between Ireland and the United States of America. Again, rooted in the relationship between President Kennedy and Seán Lemass, and passed down through generations of our ancestors that has built this relationship that is both unique as well as mutually not only agreeable, but beneficial. And, you know, I believe that President Biden's commitment to the peace process in the north of Ireland, the establishment of that agreement, and the continuation and commitment of the Good Friday Belfast Agreement is essential to the growth and prosperity of Ireland, to the ultimate unification and the vision, again, set forth by Seán Lemass and so many other freedom fighters over 100 years ago, that ultimately becomes a reality, but it does so in a democratic and a peaceful way. And that has been established in 1998, and we need to continue to focus on that. So the commitment of this administration and of Congress to that Good Friday Belfast Agreement is essential and to growing it, but also in ensuring that we have an open line of business between Ireland and the United States, where businesses are prospering on both sides of the Atlantic that help to grow jobs and opportunity in the economy for those that stay in Ireland, as well as those that stay here in the US, and that is an unfettered border of economic growth that we can all grab onto, so that again, those that are the youth, that are the future, that are going to build their roots on both sides of the Atlantic, we continue to grow our economies both exclusively and together, that those that want to live and work and raise their families and set up roots like past generations in Ireland and in the United States have the ability to do so. The best way to do that is to give businesses the opportunity to grow. And I think that that's what President Biden is doing.
Yeah, thanks for that, Tim. I'll just add my own two penny pence to it as well. Like, obviously, Brexit had a very significant impact on Ireland and is having a very significant impact on Ireland. But isn't importantly, our relationship with Britain is still very strong, and we want to ensure that we retain a very strong relationship with Britain. But there was absolutely a fundamental requirement of Ireland, and the whole political establishment in Ireland agreed on this, that we could not allow a hard border to develop on the island of Ireland. Like, it would have just been contrary to everything that Seán Lemass tried to achieve, that we achieved through the Good Friday Agreement, and that has been achieved in recent years as well. I just want to publicly acknowledge that really the support of the United States political system, particularly through President Biden, but also through the houses of legislature there, has been very important to Ireland in ensuring that no hard border was placed on the island of Ireland. Because in real politique, as we want the United Kingdom to do well. Like there's no antagonism between us and the United Kingdom. We want to see them prosper outside the European Union. We're sorry for them to go. But I suppose one of the holy grails for the United Kingdom is to have a free trade agreement with the United States. And listen, we hope that the United Kingdom does, but it appears to be a very clear message coming from President Biden and from politicians in the United States that that won't happen if there's any attempts to put a hard border on Ireland. And just on behalf of every politician in Ireland, I want to just thank you and the American political system for ensuring that you're supportive of us.
Well, thank you for saying so. You know, it is absolutely essential that there is no hard border put in place, either, you know, now nor in the future. And we know, especially during this very difficult and tumultuous time as we're coming out of the pandemic, and as we, all of us and from the global community, have had to look inward, we have seen there are elements of society across the globe that want to take us backwards. And we cannot allow forces to take us backwards to what I would refer to as the bad old days. We need to make sure that that border is open for not only progress, but for the economy and for the future unification. And Jim, I want to thank you and all of your work as a member of government, someone who is vocal and recognizes the importance of our relationship here in the United States to Ireland, and one that is continuing to work to develop that relationship. I also want to recognize my friend, Senator Malcolm Byrne, who is the head of the U.S.-Ireland Parliamentary Relations. And having someone like Senator Byrne and again, you, Jim, and so many others that I could name, I'd be here all day. We'd get done with that hour very quickly. And I don't want to leave anybody out also. But, you know, it's essential that we have these relationships. And so to have government officials on both sides of the Atlantic that are committed to not only seeing the fruits of that agreement that were laid back in 1998 come to fruition, but also, again, the vision of Seán Lemass and so many other freedom fighters become the reality into the future. Hopefully it's in our lifetime, but we're passing that message on to our future generations as well.
Yes, sir. Thanks. Rory, there's a question's come in from Maria, and I'm going to throw it at you if you don't mind.
Go ahead.
Because I suspect you'll give a better answer than I will. And it's about the Scottish elections last week. And it says, following the results of the Scottish elections last week, there were calls for another referendum on Scottish independence. What are the implications for Ireland and the prospects for a border poll here? I'll leave that to you, Rory.
I think, Jim, it's quite, as a Republican myself, I think it's quite exciting times ahead. But I'm also cautious because I do think there will be independent Scotland definitely within my lifetime. And I think what happens after it becomes independent is either going to be a catalyst or it's going to be a deterrent for United Ireland, because I think a lot of kind of middle ground in United in Northern Ireland who don't consider themselves unionist or nationalists will kind of look over at Scotland and see if they're successful and if their quality of life is higher and if their kind of their children's lives are looking bright ahead. I think there'd be no debate about uniting Ireland if Scotland is successful and the quality of life is higher. I think there's other implications far, far forward. If Scotland does join the EU, I think we won't be the only English-speaking country in the EU. And I think Scotland will have want to kind of put forward tax changes, which want to kind of make Scotland, how do I put it? Want to follow a way which is successful, which is Ireland's way currently with taxation around corporation tax and bringing in loads of jobs. So that's something to watch out for too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in terms of Scotland, I suppose one of the arguments, and we probably don't recognize it here in Ireland as much, one of the arguments in favor of Scottish independence is that they say, look at Ireland. Look what happened to Ireland. It left the United Kingdom 100 years ago or so, and it has become a very successful economy. Now, we know the reasons for that are significantly to do with Seán Lemass. But when you look at arguments now that are raised against Scottish independence, one of the big arguments is economically it's not viable. And like similarly, that was an argument which, you know, could have been used 100 years ago. But like we had a team of our expert economists together looking in 1916 as to whether or not Ireland should become an independent republic. All of them would have said, you're crazy, don't go for this. You won't be able to support yourselves financially. So like there's a leap of faith required as well when it comes to making momentous decisions like that. And I suppose it was a leap of faith that we made. But again, I just want to emphasize, had we not had our direction changed by Seán Lemass in the 1950s and into the 1960s, and we saw the benefits of that in the 80s, 90s, 2000s, and up to now, if we hadn't done that, I think we'd be having a different discussion about independence. People may say, well, it probably wasn't worthwhile because we haven't economically progressed. That's the questions that have come in. There was a couple of them that come in. I'm conscious I'm going on a bit. And Eimear, did you want to wrap up or what did you want to say?
Well, yes, I just thought, thank you, Jim, for that. And thank you for the participants who sent in the questions. Sorry, we didn't get the time to get to more of them. We'll just have to do it. We'll just all have to regather for his 100th anniversary, I suppose. But finally, my cousin, Rory O'Connor, who at age 20 was elected as a county councillor for the Wicklow constituency of Bray East, and is the youngest member of the Lemass family to be elected to public office. So Rory, you might say a few words to wrap up for us this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. Firstly, I'd like to thank all the speakers, Jim, Tim and Eimear, and all who attended this event. Living with COVID-19 has quite frankly been a struggle for all. It has given us time for reflections about ourselves and what will happen after COVID. One of the factors which made Lemass great was his ability to create hope in a rather feeling of hopelessness in our society. Events such as meeting JFK, the leader of the free world, and a proud Irish man, which would cement Ireland and America's relationship forever. This can be seen again with yet another proud Irish American in the White House. But what made Lemass different was his ability to create hope, but also deliver on it. This relationship has had a long-lasting impact on Irish society, with about 1,060,000 people directly employed by US companies in Ireland today. I believe this is exactly what we need to take forward after COVID-19 as public representatives. We need to create hope for the public, but also deliver on it. Thank you.
Well done, Rory. Thank you very much. And just to say thank you very much, everybody, particularly Senator Tim. We really appreciate you taking the time out. We look forward to seeing you in Ireland with President Biden, perhaps as well. And to Jim. Thanks, Jim. I know you're busy fighting, about to fight a by-election, so I'm sure it's all systems go in your area.
That's correct, Jim.
And best of luck with that. Obviously, as the party of Seán Lemass, you'll have a spirit there right beside you as you go about your work. So thanks, Rory, and thanks all the participants. And just thank you all for remembering Seán today.
Thank you.
It was an honor. Have a wonderful day. Wonderful evening.